Yeah, if this is your first time, we're kind of a joke. So, well, most churches just throw money at everything. So they have, you know, like a $20,000 setup in the back room where people play with little boards and devices and do all the stuff that you're seeing happen. But we don't pay anybody. So we just, whatever the Lord does, we let the money go towards ministry. So how dare we? I know. It's horrible. It's a tragedy. So today we are going to be doing communion. We do, our philosophy regarding communion is we don't want to do it so often that we begin to count it as a common thing and take it lightly, but we also don't want to do it so rarely that we forget the importance of it. We want to do it, you know, we usually do it about every 3 months, something like that. So that way we can dedicate the time that we believe it deserves. I don't know, you know, it's kind of, and let each do according to their own conviction, but, you know, we want to definitely give it the seriousness that we think it deserves. You know, some churches, it's just some people take it in passing, but if you read the Bible, you would never think that that's something you should do. It's something that you want to do with seriousness. So we definitely try to take communion seriously. The Lord, in the Bible, he does not command us to do a lot of ordinances. He's made it pretty easy for us. We have baptism and we have communion. You know, there's other things that you could put below that on the list of things that we should do, gathering together, fellowshipping, you know, koinonia, breaking bread together as a church family, these kinds of things, and we definitely do these things. But in terms of ordinances that are required of us as Christians, baptism, communion, he's made it pretty easy for us. Again, these things are not the things that we do to be saved. These are the things that we do because we are saved. So we want to, you know, make sure we mention that right up front. Basically, Jesus instituted communion first and foremost, so that we could remember what he went through to secure our salvation and what was purchased when he secured our salvation on the cross. Nowadays, you'll hear a lot of different things, and a lot of them are just completely foreign to the pages of Scripture. They're just not in the Bible at all. You know, in some denominations, they treat communion as some sort of metaphysical or esoteric rite that you have to, you know, that through that you're essentially saved. Without that, you cannot be saved. All sorts of, you know, weird things. You see it with baptism as well, where some denominations teach baptismal regeneration, that you're saved through baptism. These things are not in the Bible. So we just try to focus on what the Bible says. The Bible, Jesus very clearly, when he institutes communion, says, do this in remembrance of me. So we don't want to neglect the importance of communion, but we also don't want to put the cart in front of the horse and act like communion is the be-all, end-all of the Christian faith. It's symbolic, just like baptism. And in communion, we're symbolizing the fellowship that was broken in the Garden of Eden that was restored on the cross. And of course, we do that looking back 2,000 years later on the work that Christ accomplished on the cross when he purchased our salvation. Now, yesterday when I was working on this message, I was, you know, prayerfully contemplating what angle to take in communion, because there's a lot of different angles you can take. You can talk about, you know, the eschatological aspect of it, how very soon we're going to have communion face-to-face with Jesus, right? The marriage supper of the Lamb. You know, we could talk about that. We've done that before. There's a bunch of different angles you can take, but the Lord just was not showing me anything for hours. And it was a little bit before dinner time when I was just prayerfully considering this, and the Lord finally showed me the angle that he wanted us to take this morning. And it was an angle that I was like, okay, well, we'll do that. And so basically, the angle we're going to take today is that our communion is first and foremost to be about God, with God. Why do I say that? Because nowadays, there's this huge emphasis in the church, this very trendy emphasis in the church on community. Raise your hand if you've ever heard a church use the word community. All right. Everyone, right? Be honest. You guys have all heard this. Community. Yeah. No. So the Bible, it's so important the Bible completely forgot to mention that word. Imagine in the context of the church or communion. Like, imagine. So important. God's like, totally forgot that one. But fortunately, the Christians, once it becomes very trendy, will remember in the year 20, you know, the late 2000s, the late half of the, sorry guys, I'm on day three of a headache, just bear with me. My brain, it's mush. I don't know what happened, but day three of this headache, it's pretty phenomenal. But basically here now, we finally figured out the importance of community that was so important. The patristics, the early church fathers, the writers of scripture, everyone forgot to mention it. It's so important. But fortunately, now that we're all super woke and everything, we've remembered the importance of community and communism. I mean, fellowship. So, no. It's crazy because right after the Lord had showed me that and I began writing my notes, I talked with one of you guys who had gone to a different church last weekend for a baptism that was going on. You wanted to be there for your family member's baptism and everything. And you were talking about how they did communion. And the whole angle they took was community. It's all about community with one another. That's actually blasphemous. Straight up blasphemous. Like, that's blasphemy. We're doing it to remember what Jesus went through to purchase our salvation, not so that we can fellowship with one another. Newsflash, you're pretty lousy. We're all pretty lousy. It's not like, oh, thank goodness we have church family. Are you kidding? Churchianity in America, church hopping. You guys probably been to four churches this month. I mean, let's be honest, right? It's community. Yeah, for what, 30 seconds? Come on. You're like, new church. Yeah, like, church splits have happened over, like, what color the carpet is. We solved that one. You know, they've happened over, you know, where the clock is or what. Look around. You won't see one. Because the last thing I want is the Holy Spirit to be stifled by me being like, oh, my gosh, it's been an hour and 8 minutes. I better cut off the Holy Spirit. There's no clock over here. I don't have some clock in the back with a countdown. Wrap it up. Hurry up, Holy Spirit. Church is gone. Stick a fork in it. This is the shambles of Christianity, what we're witnessing here in the late stages of the Church of Laodicea. And gone with it is communion. Communion has become about us. God forbid. God forbid. That's terrifying. James 3:1 apparently has been ripped out of the Bibles of most of the pastors in America, in the world, because we're going to get a harder judgment. We better take this stuff seriously. Communion is not about you. Communion is about Jesus and what he accomplished for us on the cross. It's not about communion with our fellow man or community. It's about Jesus. It's about the fellowship that was lost in the Garden of Eden when man rebelled and gave the title deed to earth to Satan. When does that get taken back? In the book of Revelation, that's what those seals are being opened to retake the scroll. John wept convulsively because no one was found worthy. Had to be a man. No man was found worthy to take the scroll. But Jesus, fully man, fully God, was found worthy to take the scroll, right? And now that's being taken back in the book of Revelation, which will happen very shortly. Klaus Schwab is working very hard to ensure that that's the case. So we're getting very close, but it's not about the fellowship and community we have with one another. It's about the fellowship and community that was restored on the cross. And if we ever lose sight of that, we've done ourselves and God a terrible disservice. It's not a joke. It's very serious. Paul talks about people, I think it's 1 Corinthians 11, he talks about some people that have taken communion to their own detriment. Like, if we take communion with the wrong heart, you're in danger, unless the Bible lied. And I'm pretty sure it didn't. So we want to be very careful the heart with which we take communion. It's to be a very serious, joyful, but serious circumstance, event. It's not something we take lightly or flippantly, or that we, you know, we fill a super soaker with grape juice and everybody open your mouths, shh, throwing crackers. No, no. baptisms with water slides and everything. You're just like, what are you guys doing? Terrifying. We've turned church into an amusement park. And you know what? When you take out the word of God, you better do that. Because if the word of God is exciting, it changes lives, it saves souls, these kinds of things. If you've removed that, well, you better have some fun gimmicks. Because then you're no longer feeding the sheep, you're entertaining the goats. Terrifying. So we definitely want to make sure we don't have a misplaced focus on community. You know, like we talked about, that word community is not used anywhere in the Bible in relation to the ecclesia, or the communion act or anything like that. God totally forgot to mention it. No, it's not the focus. The focus is on Jesus. It must always be on Jesus. Think about it, church. Who are we with forever? Jesus. Who are we with when we stand in front of God and face judgment? Jesus. Whether it be the Bema seat or the white throne, Jesus, you're standing in front of him. Every knee will bow, every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God. We don't want to get that wrong. We want to focus on the main thing, and the main thing is Jesus Christ. Sure, as a church family, if we're in Christ, we will all be together forever. Praise the Lord. That's a beautiful thing. But don't assume to know God's plan. For all we know, he'll have us stationed in different parts of the galaxy, and some of you are probably hoping for that. You're like, I have to be with them forever? Yeah, we don't know, right? But we do know we'll be with Jesus, right? So the focus should always be Jesus. The church family is a beautiful thing, and, you know, we'll talk more about restoration that comes, you know, the time of restitution of all things. But the focus should be on Jesus, because who are we going to be with forever? Jesus. You know, and this is why God allows so many of the trials and tribulations of this life. Because we're going to be with him forever. And he wants us to really know him. Not to have our relationship with him centered and focused on other people. How tragic. In case you haven't noticed, people will let you down. I won't ask for a show of hands, but I'm pretty sure everyone in this room, if you're walking with the Lord or have been for a good amount of time, you've been let down by fellow believers, sometimes catastrophically. God allows these trials and tribulations because the focus, the relationship, must always be centered on God. You know, I remember talking with my wife years ago about this topic. And we were discussing how almost every pastor we've ever, this is before we were in ministry, almost every pastor we've ever heard has been wrong in our estimation, right? About at least one or two things. You know, it seems like nobody bats 1,000, right? Why? Because God doesn't want us to focus on this pastor, this teacher, regardless of how good they are. And many of them are tremendous. You know, I look at Chuck Smith and the influence he's had on my life and everything. But at the end of the day, we can't let that be the focus, that pastor. I can't remember. I think it's Isaiah chapter 4, where it was Isaiah didn't have his heavenly vision where he saw the Lord high and lifted up with his train filling the temple. He didn't have that vision until the year the good King Hezekiah died. Because sometimes our eyes will focus on men. And God will let them fall. God will let them, even if it's just our own imagination, we'll find some reason. Like, that's not always a bad thing. How we handle it can be terrifying. It's amazing how many people, when they leave a church, throw a grenade on the way out. It's a lot easier to leave that way, right? I had to leave. Horrible things going on. And yet they go to a church where it's 10 times worse. Don't get me started. So the focus can never be on men, regardless of how good they are. We won't see God clearly if our eyes are fixed on worldly things. And as we focus on Jesus, the things of this world grow strangely dim, right? We can't focus on men. We can't focus on anything other than Jesus. If we do, it's to our own detriment. And that's why he allows so many of these trials and tribulations, because in those storms, in those trials, if we're learning the lesson that God's trying to teach us, then we should be drawing near to the Lord as we go through these things, not running to our fellow man or to church or what have you. It's amazing how many people, and you guys have probably seen this, it's amazing how many people will have a bad experience at a church and walk away from the Lord. If you do that, your faith was in church and not in God. I use the example, and it's a great one. Feel free to borrow it. If I go to a restaurant and get sick, I probably won't go back to that restaurant. But I'm not going to stop eating. Although, it might be a good idea for a little while. Who would do that, right? Oh, I don't eat anymore. Yeah, I'm going to fast until I die now. Yes, next week. It's insanity, right? And yet how many people just throw the baby out with the bathwater? No, that's the Lord showing you that your faith was in that institution, in that man, whatever it may be, rather than in him. People will let you down. God never will. You know, friends are great. Family can be great. Church family can be great too. But those things can never take the place of true communion with God. It can never be the focus. You know, how much does he love us? Well, he became a man in the person of Jesus Christ, right? Lived the perfect life. Then he died on the cross to pay for our sins. Rose again from the dead, proving it's all true. Yeah, pretty sure your friends or family are great, but not that great, huh? Jesus loves you way more. You know, when I was praying for the Lord to bring me a wife, you know, if you want to hear more about it, we have a sermon on YouTube called The D Word, where we talk about divorce. And I was with a woman before my wife for 6 years when I was young. You know, we started dating when we were teenagers and everything like that. I grew up in Orange County in the belly of the beast. And so that relationship ended, and my prayer to the Lord I think I was 22 when I was praying it. I prayed for the Lord to bring me a woman that loved him more than me. Because if the person that you are with loves you more than the Lord, then when you disappoint them, and you will, then they're gone. But if that person loves the Lord more than they love you, then when you screw up and destroy that relationship, and you will, they stick together because they love the Lord. And the Lord says that's what he wants them to do. Remember this old pastor's wife interview going on with Kay Smith. Chuck Smith was the founder of Calvary Chapel, the Calvary Chapel movement, and his wife was Kay Smith. Just like my wife's spiritual mother, right? It was awesome when I was at the Bible college and they were getting rid of the books out of the library. I bought a bunch of the books. And we love George Mueller. He's like, we do the Mueller model in terms of our life and ministry. And so I got this biography I got it home, and it was Kay Smith's personal copy. And I was like, oh, yeah. So I gave it to my wife for her birthday. But at that time, you know, we were listening to this interview with Kay Smith. And the interviewer, this other pastor's wife, she said, did you guys ever think of divorce? It's been hard over the years, so many crazy things in ministry. And she said, divorce, no. Murder, yes. You know, and that's till death do us part. You know, no, I'm kidding. I can arrange that. No, so that's the heart we got to have, though, right? If you're willing to give up, is it going to last? If it's an option, won't you use every option? What happens? Marriage is like a war sometimes. And in a war, you use every available weapon. And if that weapon's there in the repertoire, eventually it will be used. That's why you can never even consider divorce. Can never be considered an option. Rabbit trail. But our fellowship with God, luckily God doesn't divorce us. Praise the Lord, right? He takes us back. We're that cheating wife, that adulterous wife that the scriptures use this imagery. Don't get offended. Jesus says, blessed are those who are not woke and offended because of me. So many things are not politically correct, but our culture is like a little pile of ants, like shaking its fist at God. We disagree. God's like, cute. You know, when ministering to people that are not Christian, don't have a Christian worldview. I always discuss with them our fallen nature and say, do you think it might be maybe possible that your worldview is slightly tinted by the fall? Yeah, we're all screwed up. There's things that when we come to God, I remember we were talking with one of you guys, when I get to heaven, I'm giving Paul a piece of my mind. And we're like, yeah, that's the Holy Spirit speaking through Paul. You better be wearing a diaper. It's not, we're all screwed up. Our minds are screwed up. But luckily, God shapes us and conforms us into his image, right? Praise the Lord for that. We talk about the tenses of salvation, how we've been saved from the penalty of sin, we're being saved from the power of sin, and eventually we'll be saved even from the presence of sin. And we look for that. We look forward to that. But thank God, if you guys are in Christ, you're not the person that you were 5 years ago, right? You're not the person that you were 10 years ago. He's changing you. He's conforming you into his image. He's smoothing those rough edges down. And how part of the way he does that is through trials and tribulations. And hopefully you're running to him, not to your fellow man. Sometimes God will let you hit rock bottom. He'll let you go through things that are not pleasant to go through. Why? Because sometimes we don't realize God is all we need until God is all we have. And sometimes he'll bring you to the end of yourself. And some of you guys are pretty crafty, pretty resourceful. And so that'll be a long road down. And it can be very painful. But he loves you enough to do that. He loves you enough to allow these things to happen in your life. And your life is full of distractions. It's so easy to get distracted and lose sight of what really matters. But it helps when we do communion, because then we remember what Christ went through to save us. It helps us refocus on what really matters. And this life is hard. Not only is this world full of distractions, but this life is hard. It's easy to get weighed down by the cares of this life, the hurt, the drama, the pain. But when we focus on Jesus, when we observe communion, we remember the eternal, that this is all passing away. The Bible says the man is appointed 70 years, maybe by reason of strength, 80. Some of you are on borrowed time. Life goes quick, doesn't it? When I used to minister at nursing homes, back when we were planting a church in New York before Cuomo shut it down with COVID and everything, I used to talk to the older folks in the nursing homes, and I'd always say to them, the days go slowly, but the years go quickly. And how true that is. I'm sure most of you guys, depending on how old you are, you might remember playing with Legos, or some of you guys, Tinker Toys and, Lincoln Logs or whatever. And some of you guys probably sticks and rocks. It's the only toys my kids get. We're back there with you guys. Don't worry. We're in the Stone Age at my house. My children are like, stick a toy. Yeah. I think Bradley was five before he realized McDonald's wasn't old. McDonald had a farm. He saw a restaurant and he was like, this is not, wait, what? He was so confused. He's like, what happened here? I remember when his favorite food was purple cabbage. He didn't want ice cream. He's like, no. Yeah, you think you got it bad, teens? Glad you're not in my family. But the cares of this life, they can weigh you down. They can beat you up. God loves us enough that he lets us go through these things because he wants us to focus on him. He wants us to run to him. And when we do communion, we remember what Jesus went through to save us. It refocuses us. It gets our hearts back in the right place. And that's what should be happening as we take communion, as we're circumspectly considering these things. It's a reminder of our most important relationship, our relationship with God. And that's why communion is only for those who are saved. Those who have a relationship with Jesus, those who know Jesus as the love of their life and their greatest joy. The Bible itself talks about a closed communion. So we don't have a closed communion to church members. We don't have any church membership because there's only one church, and I'm not the shepherd. I'm the under shepherd. The Lord is the real shepherd, and we're all part of the church, the body of Jesus Christ. But we would ask that if you're not walking with the Lord, if you're not a Christian, if you're not saved that you would not take communion, because the Bible itself says this. So that's something that's between you guys. We're not going to, you know, individually ask you 30 questions. You guys know if you're walking with the Lord, you know if you're not. And if you're not, don't take communion. Get saved, then take communion. You know, I won't ask for a show of hands, but I'm sure if I asked how many of you guys have been hurt or had broken relationships with other Christians in this life, I'm pretty sure every hand would go up, because we've all had relationships with fellow believers that we were very close to, that were very dear to us. We've had those relationships broken, right? Just part of the reality of living in this fallen world. We're all screwed up, and hopefully less so as we grow in Christ, but the reality of the situation is we hurt each other, you know. We make bad choices. That's a tragic thing. We've all had falling outs with those who were once near and dear to us in the body of Christ. It hurts, and it can be crippling. And yet, if we have a relationship with Jesus Christ, we know that one day there will be restoration in all those broken relationships with fellow believers. In Acts chapter 3, verse 21, it talks about the time of the restoration of all things. Isn't that a beautiful promise to think about? That all these things in this world that are broken, God's going to come fix. That all these relationships that have been broken in our own lives, in the body of Christ, those things will be repaired. Those things will be fixed. Yeah, I know some of you guys have been divorced, and you're both Christian. You just couldn't make it work because we're all screwed up. Isn't that a beautiful thought, that one day there will be restoration in that relationship, that in eternity you won't always be like, oh, there they come. Isn't that a beautiful thought? That's awesome, right? What an incredible thing to think about. In the hereafter, all that will be fixed. And yet, as exciting and beautiful as that'll be, it'll pale in comparison to the indescribable relationship we'll enjoy with Christ in eternity. That's, again, that's the true focus. That's the true relationship that we all long for, that our hearts long for. Human relationships can be awesome. They can also be painful. And the reality is, we were created in the image of God because God desires to have a relationship with us. That's what we were truly created for, a relationship with God, to walk with God, to fellowship with God, to commune with God. And that fellowship, that communion, begins the moment we get saved, the moment we place our faith in Jesus Christ, enabling a relationship, facilitating a relationship with God. Isaiah chapter 59, verses 1 and 2, they talk about how our sin separates us from God. Talks about how God's arm's not too short that he can't save, or his ear is not deaf that it cannot hear, but our sins have separated us from God. That's why when we're not saved, we're not walking with the Lord, and we're going through some hard time, and we're just like, oh, you know, God, why would you let this happen? He's like, you won't let me help you. You won't let me fix your life. Why? Because he does it his way, not your way, and at the end of the day, you want it your way. We all do. But your way doesn't end well, in case you haven't noticed that in the mess of a life that you've made for yourself. And I'm not talking outward success. Many of you guys have been wildly successful in the eyes of the world, but you know when your head hits that pillow at night that you're a mess. So many people who are wildly successful in the eyes of the world kill themselves, right? Wildly successful people commit suicide because they know that this measure of success that the world holds up is false. It's a joke. None of these things in this life are ever going to make you happy. Haven't you noticed? How many of you guys remember before you were walking with the Lord? You can be doing very good in the eyes of the world, but every night when your head hits that pillow, you know that you're a fraud. You know the deep, dark thoughts of your heart. You know the ways you've screwed up. You know the people that you failed, the people that you've hurt. You know the life that you've lived has been wrong. And that's all of us. People think Christians are supposed to be perfect. No, we're not perfect. We're forgiven. Big difference. Right? I talk to my kids all the time. I tell them pastor is not spelled P-E-R-F-E-C-T. I'm just a sinner saved by grace. We all are. And yet, when we come to Christ, we then can lead other people. We joke, we're just one beggar showing other beggars where to get the bread. Jesus. He's the only one that'll ever satisfy you. He's the only one that'll ever make you happy. Because you were created for a relationship with God. And until you have that, nothing's going to make you happy. Romans 6:23 tells us the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. And if that life, that eternal life, if that was all we got, that would be more than enough, right? That would be a fantastic deal. Agreed? If all we got was just being saved from the penalty of our sin and hell, being separated from God, that would be a good deal. We'd be like, good deal. Awesome. But that's not all that we get. We also get a relationship with God. That thing that we were originally created for, to walk with God, to fellowship with God, to commune with God. Imagine. Don't settle for community with man when you can have communion with God. Such a better deal. Don't get deceived by those who would say that our communion with God only begins in eternity. No, our communion with God should begin the day that we get saved. That's the whole purpose. We now come before him. We come before the throne of grace boldly, right? We cry out, Abba, Father, like Daddy, right? We have a relationship there. Jesus says, I no longer call you my servants, you're my friends. Do we deserve that, church? But are we taking advantage of that? Jesus says our relationship with God is the basis for our salvation. If you came from a denominational background, particularly like a Catholic background, that might offend you. But that's what Jesus himself says. Our relationship with God is the basis for our salvation. That's why when people go to hell, what does Jesus say to them? Depart from me, I never knew you. There was no relationship. But there can be. Our fellowship, our communion with God isn't just a perk. It's a prerequisite. You should be fellowshipping with God. You should be communing with God. Before going to the cross, Jesus tells his disciples, do this in remembrance of me, instituting communion for his followers. And today, corporately, as a church family, we're now going to celebrate and partake in communion, remembering what Jesus went through to save us, to reestablish fellowship, communion. The communion that we enjoy because Christ went to the cross and paid for our sins, so that through faith in him we can be saved. So we're now going to pass out the bread and the cup, and then we'll partake together as a church. So I was going to ask Ryan and Pastor Steve to come forward and pass out the communion elements. And we'll just wait together until everybody has it, and then we will partake together as a church family.
We fall down, we lay
Lord Jesus, we thank you for what you went through on the cross to save us from our sins. Lord, we thank you that not only did you save us, Lord, but that you also reestablished that fellowship, that communion that we lost when we rebelled against you. Lord, we thank you for that. We thank you that your body was broken, Lord. We thank you that your blood was spilt, because it was us that deserved that, Lord. You paid for our punishment on the cross. And Lord, we thank you that you've given us communion, just like you've given us baptism, Lord, as a reminder. And Lord, we now partake of the bread and the cup, remembering you. We thank you that your body was broken. We thank you that your blood was spilt, that you saved us, and that you've reestablished, Lord, that relationship, that communion that we once had with you. So Lord, we now partake together of the cup and the bread. So now we're just going to listen to one more worship song and just spend some time with the Lord quietly in our hearts. And then after that, we'll pray and dismiss in fellowship.
Give me Jesus. Give me
We love you, Lord. We thank you for this time when we can gather together as a church family and partake in communion, remembering what you did to save us, Lord, what you did to reestablish communion with you, with the Father, with the Holy Spirit, Lord. And God, we pray that you would now bless the time of fellowship that we're going to have as a church family, Lord. We love you. We praise you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. So I love you guys. I will see you guys on Wednesday night. We're going to be doing a prophecy news update, talking about all the insane stuff going on in the world, how it points us to Jesus Christ and his soon return. Otherwise, see you guys on next Sunday, where we'll be resuming our way through the Gospel of Mark. So I love you guys. God bless you guys. Save us.